Will you all honor me as we honor this great man with the singing of our national anthem, to which he fought, loved, and respected. Sing through me, my king. Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er a land of the free and the home of the brave?
I'm Denton Harlan from Lane's Funeral Home. I welcome all of you here today to pay respects to a man who we've described as a man who saw the elephant, if you will. He's a veteran. He served honorably, retired from the Air Force, served in the Marines. The only service that he did not serve with was the Coast Guard, and that was probably in his heart as well, because that's the one he wanted to join. In either case, God bless all of you for being here. Gordon C. Sage says right on the front of a folder, our moral compass, artist, teacher, husband, father, grandfather, uncle, friend, and a proud veteran of the United States. We thank you all for coming. God bless you for being here. I understand that his daughter has some words to say for us, but in either case, thank you. God bless all of you. And ma'am, it's your turn.
Gordon Sage was truly a man that stood out amongst men. He was a moral compass for anyone that met him, and he never preached to them. He believed everyone is on their own journey in life. He was the most humble man I've ever encountered. He would tell me that the most important thing in life was to become civilized. To him, this meant kindness to all, true humbleness, and a temperance in everything. He found joy in life. My father was born and raised in a two-room mountain shack on a small ranch at the foot of Mount Rushmore in the beautiful Black Hills of South Dakota. In the winter, the snow would come through the cracks and deposit snow on his bed that was made of bed straw. He ran free in this picturesque resort area, long a summer retreat for tourists. And this endowed him with a lifelong love of wildlife, nature, and scientific beauty. He spent his youth hunting and fishing along the pristine streams of the Ponderosa pine-covered hills. It was here that he acquired an innate knowledge of nature. At a very young age, it became evident that he was born with a natural ability to take that nature knowledge and turn it into artistic masterpieces. My grandmother was a widow with four children when she remarried. Her new husband moved her and her children from a nice farm in eastern South Dakota to the Black Hills. He built them a two-room shack, and then he decided to walk out on the family and desert them to fend for themselves when my father was less than 2 years old. My grandmother scraped together a life for them and managed to instill high values and work ethics in all of her children. During the Depression, there were times when my father, if he didn't get a rabbit, they didn't eat. His first 8 years of school, he attended a one-room school. And the stories of walking to school miles through a foot of snow was true in his case. Most of the young people graduated after the eighth grade in those days, but my father was driven to continue his education. So his freshman year, being no school around there, high school, he farmed himself out to a family in Rapid City, South Dakota to work for them so he could continue his education. It was here that a teacher recognized his rare talent and took him under her wing. And he started working in oils and dreamed of going to art school. September 1939, his senior year, Hitler's troops invaded Poland. So he decided to join the National Guard to help his country. Then in 1940, he made another decision. When he graduated from high school, he felt it was his duty to his country, so he switched to the U.S. Marine Corps, hitchhiking all the way to Minneapolis, Minnesota, without a dime in his pocket, to the recruiting center. He was soon sent to boot camp in Pendleton, near San Diego, California, and was assigned to a seagoing Marine unit. At age 20, he was assigned to Rear Admiral Walter Stanton Anderson and on the USS Virginia as his orderly. Admiral Anderson was the commander of the battleship fleet in the Pacific Theater. They were moored in Battleship Row in November of 1941. The Admiral moved to the USS Maryland and took his staff with him. So my dad left behind many friends and moved to the USS Maryland. On Sunday, December 7th, 1941, Gordon was shining his shoes and getting ready to spend his day off ashore. At about 7:55, the Japanese warplane struck. My dad started hearing explosions. He thought the Army was just practicing its big guns. A friend came to the door and he said, "This is it." Pearl Harbor was being bombed. Going to the door, he saw the Oklahoma tilting over and the West Virginia was sinking in front of it. The sailors on the Maryland were throwing ropes to the men in the oil-filled waters. My father was dumb with disbelief. He had been told they couldn't sink a battleship. The bay was on fire and the flames were right up against the ship. He thought about his friends on the Virginia, of which he lost many. And soon he was in line passing ammunition to an anti-aircraft gun until the admiral came aboard and Gordon took up his duties as orderly. The Maryland was struck with 3 blows, but spared heavy damage. It crippled out of the harbor and went to Puget Sound Navy Shipyard in Bremerton, Washington, for repairs. In Seattle, he met the love of his life, Patricia Decker, and was married. He had proposed to her on their second date. She said, "No, I can't marry you. You're going to war." And he said, "I promise I'll come back." And she said, "Okay." She was 17 and he was 20 years old. They got married on their third date. They were on a 62-year honeymoon until he lost her in 2003. He returned to active duty and participated in the landing of Tarawa in the Gilbert Islands, fighting on through the Marshall Islands to the Marianne Islands of Guam, Saipan, and then eventually onto the landing of Iwo Jima. He never, ever forgot his friends on the West Virginia. After World War II, Gordon was honorably discharged from the Marines, and he chose to go to that art school he dreamt of. But now he had a small family that he was concerned about, so he put his dreams on hold once more and re-enlisted into the military. This time to the Army Air Corps. I just want to add, the reason is because the admiral had told him when he did get married that if he had wanted him to have a wife, he would have issued him one. So he decided that the Army and the Air Corps were better for the family. He truly loved the Marines, but he also loved the Air Force. He chose the Air Force branches when it separated, and he kept close ties with his art, serving as an illustrator for the next 15 years, I believe, I don't know, and painting in his spare time. Gordon put in another 20 years teaching in the Evergreen School District here in Clark County, Washington, where he has called home for his last 58 years. He spent his life exploring the potential of oil paint with all its richness, variety, and texture. Gordon Sage was a versatile and prolific artist. The greater part of his output consisted of Native American themes, encompassing Native myths, customs, and dress. The rest of his work was comprised of landscapes, wildlife, portraits, and literary themes. Most of his work created in the last 20 years had been painted with palette knife. He also enjoyed sculpting and did many bronze pieces. Always driven to get an education, he kept pushing until his dream was met. His formal art training began in Colorado Springs Fine Art Center, where he studied under Boardman Robinson. Later, Gordon graduated from Arizona State University with honors and received his master's degree from Lewis and Clark College in Portland, Oregon. Mr. Sage has sold to collectors in Japan, France, South Dakota, Arizona, California, Portland, Oregon, Seattle, and Vancouver, Washington. My father touched everyone's soul just by meeting him and has left a hole in all of our lives. He will always be remembered as a true gentleman, a scholar, a talented artist, and a modest soul with a sense, great, great sense of humor and laughter. He saw great beauty in life, and he did his best to see as much of planet Earth as he could. A true traveler, from climbing mountains such as Mount Fujiyama in Japan and riding camels in Egypt at age 89, and climbing pyramids in Mexico in his 90s. He was truly a great man among men. And now an owl has called his name, but he's never going to leave our hearts.
I'm Polly. Thank you for the message. I was one of his students, and him and I painted the mural at Covington Junior High School after I had graduated. And my mother and I are both nurses, and my mother took care of your grandmother years ago. So I have a painting he did for my graduation. I don't remember if it was my high school or my nursing, but he was always supportive, wonderful, my favorite teacher, the most wonderful man you'd ever know. So I appreciate the opportunity to have him as my teacher and everything else. So thank you.
So Gordon was also my teacher, and met him when I was 14 years old. So I've known him for 45 years. And he's the type of guy, whenever I talk about positive affirmations, I think of him. And he's inspired my life to do that with other people. Because I could go to Gordon and say, I'd like to be a ballerina. And he would say, you would look great in a tutu. So in high school, I told Gordon I was going to go in the Marines. And he said, that'd be good for you. It'd keep you out of trouble. He encouraged my brother to go in the Air Force and me to go in the Marine Corps. My son is currently in the Marine Corps boot camp. So we have a special bond. I know that Gordon's watching out for him now. He's on his third weekend. He's doing martial arts training. So I just want to leave with one thing. You think about where you were when you were 19 or 20 years old. Some of us going in the military. Some people going to college. Some people entering the workforce. Gordon was on the Maryland, protecting the rights that we have for this country to be free. And he kept that story pretty quiet until later in life. We became really good friends. And the age gap didn't matter. And when he was leaving Iwo Jima, he was on the fantail of the boat. And I remember he told me, he said it was a big day. After the war was over on Iwo Jima, they let him swim in the bay. And so they got to get clean because they went 33 days without a shower. I guess they didn't want him on the boat unless they had one. So he was leaving Iwo Jima, and I just want to recite the poem that he wrote as he was leaving. 4,000 strong they lie there, beneath their crosses white. The heroes of this bloody lair no more shall see the light. O'er their graves the ensign flies, their comrades pay respect. But they look up with sightless eyes, no thoughts their minds reflect. Beneath them shifts the bloody sands, above them rolls the sea, heroes of this wasted land, champions of the free. At home the sun shines overhead, not quite today. Some people there are gay, they soon forget our hallowed dead, the price we had to pay.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. In the years' time that I knew him, I don't think I've ever been so moved by a person as I was with him. You know, he immediately became my grandpa, like everybody else. And I just want to say what an honor it is to have been able to be there with him.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Toni Burnett, and Mr. Sage was one of my instructors when I was at Covington. We were doing shop leather work, and at that time we didn't have a whole lot of money, and he paid for my fees so I could take his class, and I'll never forget that.
Thank you.
On behalf of the sons and daughters of Pearl Harbors, this is a sad day for us because he was our last one here in Clark County, but he was a vibrant part of our group and he will be missed. And I know he's up there with Grandpa Swap and Sea Stories. So.
My name is Larry and I'm in the art field and worked with Gordon for quite a few years in the bronze industry, and he was truly an amazing person. And then we would get together about every week and go out for dinner here the last few years. So I'll truly miss him, and he was very talented and quite a friend.
I met Mr. Sage back in 1966, my first class, Covington Junior High for Arts and Crafts. And I was not an artist, but was required. And but I did my stuff, and I still have a few pieces that I made back there. But I got into photography later on, and I would come over to his home, and I would show him some of the weird things I was doing, especially effects work and stuff. And he liked one of my pieces. And so I gave him the picture, and I challenged him to do a painting, because I would like to have one of his pieces. And he did an abstract. Mr. Sage didn't do abstracts. And it's called The Eye of the Storm. In the bottom, there's a figure standing on a lotus flower, looking up into this chaos. And that person standing on the lotus flower is supposed to be me. And I'm buck naked up there, you know? Looking up into the eye of the storm, there's this chaos going up there, and there's this eye up there. And it is an absolutely stunning piece. And he told me that he had showed it to some of his relatives and friends, and they wanted him to do more. He said, no, this is the only one. Because he did not do abstracts. I've seen his work, Native American work, like his bisons. And I feel honored to be able to have the only piece he ever did that was not in his character. Thank you.
Hello, my name's Clay. I'm from Shelton, Washington. I knew Gordon for a short time. On 7:55 in the morning, December 7th, 1941, the country, the Imperial Japanese attacked us at Pearl Harbor. A lot of destruction, damage. 4 days later, Adolf Hitler declared war on us. And because of that attack, it reshaped the world as we know it, even today. It brought us to fight in two fronts, one in the Pacific Theater and one in the European Theater. Without our involvement, the world could have been different today. And at that time, America was we were in isolation for the rest of the world. Franklin Delano Roosevelt knew the seriousness of that. And unfortunately, because of the attack, It brought us who we are today, and Gordon was part of that living history of that morning. He is part of our living history right now. Thank you.
Thank you.
For the short time that I knew this man, he honored me. There was something about his look and his touch when he came and he took my hand. And he said to me, he says, I want to get a picture with you, Ray. And I'm like, what right do I have to get a picture with the greatness of this man who served, who taught, who strengthened so many, yet he would honor me by saying he wanted to have a picture with me, and then to say something really wonderful to me, that I'm an artist. I'm an artist. He would know. I want to thank you for the privilege of honoring this great man. Thank you. He stood for something. He fought for something. He fought for our great America. America is not a place, as we all know. America is an idea, a concept, something that never happened before. And we all live it in freedom and in power. America is here. America stands around us. We are Americans. And we will never, ever, ever not be free. Because if tomorrow all the things were gone that we worked for all our lives, and we have to start again with just our children and our wives, I thank my God above that I am living here today, because that flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget this man who died, who gave that right to me. And I'll gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt that I love this land. God bless our USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston, from New York to LA, where there's pride in every American heart, and it's time you stand and say that you're proud to be an American, where at least you know you're free. And you won't forget the men who died and gave that right to thee. And you'll gladly stand up next to me and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt that we love this land. There ain't no doubt that we love this land. There ain't no doubt that we love this land. God bless the USA.